Welcome to my fourth lecture of object-oriented design and programming. In this lecture, we are going to discuss about the second part of the fourth module, that is about threads. So this is the today's agenda. So we'll discuss about what is thread, the life cycle of thread, and creating, how can we create a thread in Java by extending thread class and by implementing the runnable interface. Then we'll discuss about Java multi-threading, Java synchronization by using synchronization block and synchronization method, and we'll end up with the thread priorities. So what is thread? So first we can check how the thread is working by using a simple example. So this is a program. This is a simple Java program. This is not a thread program. This is a simple Java program which generates odd numbers between 1 and 100 and even numbers between 1 and 100. So we have two classes. We have three classes. One class for odd numbers, one class for even numbers, and one class for one main class. So in the odd number class, we have a method generate odd numbers, which generates odd numbers between 1 and 100. And in the even number class, we have a method generate even numbers, which generates even numbers between 1 and 100. And the main method calls creates objects of these two classes and it calls generate odd numbers and generate even numbers. It's a simple program, simple Java program. When we run this program, this is output of the program. So it generates odd number first because we call the odd number program first. So it generates odd number first. Then it generates the even numbers between 1 and 100. Okay, it's a simple Java program. So in some cases, we want to execute something parallelly. So this is sequential execution because first we executed the generate odd number functions. After that, it executes the even number function. So the second program. So look at the difference. Here we implemented the thread. Here also we have three classes, odd number class, even number class, and the main class. But we implemented it by using thread. So we'll discuss about the implementation details in the upcoming session. So this is a program by using thread. And what is the difference between this program and the first program we have created? Just we can run it. So we run the program and find the difference in the output generated, because in the previous program, it generates first the odd numbers, then second the even number. But it's here it is a mixed form, right? So it generates even number, odd number one, then it generates even number. So after some even numbers, it again generates odd number, then even number, odd number, even number. So that's going on. So it can execute parallelly. So threads can execute it parallelly, but a program without thread is executed sequentially. Okay, so that is thread. So thread is a lightweight process, the smallest part of a process that can run concurrently with other parts. In our demo, we have seen that odd numbers and even numbers are generated concurrently in the thread program. But in our normal program, it generates odd numbers first and then even numbers. So another example, we are all familiar with word processor, right? So in a word processor, a background thread may check spelling and grammar, while a foreground thread processes user input, that is keystrokes. So while we are typing, a background thread will check whether the typed words are grammatically correct the type sentences are grammatically correct and type words error prone. So which is running parallel. That is the power of thread. So we can execute the things parallel. And another important aspect of thread is it is independent. If there is any exception which is happened in one thread, which will not affect in the other threads. So threads are independent one. Next, the life cycle of thread. So this is the life cycle of thread. So we have four stages. We have different stages for threads, like new, runnable, running, terminated, block, waiting, and time waiting. So a thread can be in any one of the following states during its life cycle. It may be in new state, runnable state, running state, block, wait, timed waiting, or terminated. These are also called the life cycle events of thread in Java. Let's discuss each state in detail. So we'll discuss about the first state, that is new. So as soon as you create a thread, it's in the new state. And it remains in this state until the program starts the thread using the start method. So when a thread is created, it will be in the new state and it will remain in that state until we call a start method. At this point, the thread is not alive and it's a state internal to the Java programming. So that's the first state. And second state, runnable. So calling start method on a thread put it in the runnable state. So when we call the start in our program, it put in the second state, that is runnable state. At this point, the execution control is passed to the thread scheduler to finish the execution. The scheduler decides from its point that this should be executed or not, or should put in a halt to give chance to the other runnable threads. So when we create a thread, it will be in the new state and it remains in that state until we call a start method. When a start method calls, it changes from the new state to the runnable state. Then the scheduler determines whether I have to run this thread or I have to put it in a waiting stage and complete other thread execution. So it decided by the thread scheduler. In the most OS, the operating system, the thread is given a small processing time called quantum or time slice within which it performs the execution. So a task is utilizing its quantum is said to be in running state. When the quantum expires, the thread returns to runnable state and the OS assigns another thread to the processor. The process that OS operating system used to determine which thread to dispatch is called thread scheduling, and it is dependent on the thread priorities. Okay, so to move it to the running state, so from the runnable state, the operating system decides which thread to execute. So it based upon some priorities and some predefined algorithms, which choose which thread to run. So when a thread is running, it moves from the runnable state to running state. A running thread transitions to the block state when it attempts to perform a task that cannot be completed immediately. So during its running state, if there is another task came and which will not complete which cannot be completed immediately, then the state of the thread will change from running state to the block state. And it must wait temporarily for completion of the process. When the thread issues an IO request, the OS blocks the thread from executing until that IO request completes. Once it is completed, then the blocked thread transitions to the runnable state so it can resume its operation. It's during the running state whether there is any input-output operation have to perform and which will take some time, then the thread changes from the running state to the block state, and once it is completed its operation, then it moves from the block state to the runnable state. And a thread can be put in the waiting state for various reasons. Example, it by calling a wait method or a join method. So usually a program put thread in waiting state because something else needs to be done prior to what current thread is doing. So the thread is doing something, and to complete that process which need another process have to be completed, another thread has to be executed, so it moves from the running state to the waiting state. Once waiting state is over, it informs by using the notify or notify all methods. Then it changes from waiting state to the runnable state. You can put the Java thread in a timed waiting state by calling the sleep method. So such thread returns to the runnable state when it is notified by another thread or when the timed interval expires, whichever comes first. And the timed waiting and the waiting threads cannot use the processor even the processor is available. Okay, when we call the sleep method in our program, then the thread will change from the status of the thread will change from the running to the timed waiting. And when the time expires or it is notified by some other thread, then it's changed from the timed waiting to the runnable state. And the terminator. If all the thread operations is finished, then it is moved to the terminator state. So that's about the Java thread lifecycle. So when a new process is created, it is in the new state. And when we call the start method in our program, thread program, it changes from the new state to the runnable state. If a thread is in the runnable state, then the thread scheduler decides which thread is going to run next. So when a thread is on its running state, it changes from the runnable to the running state. During running state, if there is an input-output operation which takes some time to complete, then it moves from the running state to the block state. Once the input-output operation is finished, then it's changed to the runnable state. And during the running state, if any thread program which calls join or wait operation, then the thread moves from running state to the waiting state. If a thread is in waiting state and some processor is free or available, it will not execute the waiting state threads. Which is in a waiting state, then it has to wait till the process has to be completed. After that, then it notify the thread is notified and it moves from the waiting state to the runnable state. And if it is in a running state and in the program we call the sleep method, then it moves to the timed waiting. We'll specify the time in milliseconds or nanoseconds here. So it waits till the given time in the timed waiting state. And if the time expires or some other thread notifies this thread, then it changes from the timed waiting state to the runnable state. So if all the operations performed completely, then it moves from the terminated state. So some other conditions also, if we call a run, if we call a stop method in the program also, it moves to the terminated state. Or there is some errors which is happened in the thread execution, it is also moved to the terminated state. So that's about the Java thread life cycle. Next, creating a thread in Java. There are two ways to create a thread in Java. One by extending the thread class, and second by implementing the runnable interface. So this is the method, this is the way we can extend the thread class to create a thread. And thread class is a part of java.language package. So we have to extend java.language package to implement thread in our program. So first we have to extend the java.language or thread class to create our own Java thread, and we have to override the run method. So this is the syntax, this is an example for the Java thread by extending the thread class. So here my thread is a class which extends the thread class. So every thread has, we have to override the run method, because when we call thread.start, it automatically checks for the run method and it executes the statements which is run in the run method. So we have to mandatory implement the run method. Okay, so this is my thread which extends the thread class, and we are implemented the run method. Run method is a simple method which have a string thread started running, and in the main method we have created an object of the thread, object of the my thread, and using that object we call my thread.start. So when the compiler interpret this line, compiles its line, it looks into the run method. If the run method is defined, it executed, otherwise it shows an error. Okay, next we can check this program in our Eclipse platform. So we are going to create a thread by using the extend thread class. Okay, so same program which is implemented, which I discussed previously. So we have created a thread class which extends the thread java.language to thread class, and we implemented the run method. We are overridden the run method which is already available in the thread class, and we created the object of the our thread class created, and we started the object. Okay, just run it. So it's just run the program. My thread is in running state. Okay, what happen if we place two object dot start? So we have started the thread here, and again I have written the same statement, one more start statement, and when I run this program, it throws an exception, that is illegal thread state exception. Okay, we can start a thread only once. So if you try to start it again, it throws a java.language.illegal thread state exception. Okay, so be careful about it. We have to call the start method only once in a thread. Okay, just run it, it will clear. Okay, thread is running properly. So that is the first method. So create the Java thread by extending a thread class. Okay. And the second method. And okay, then what are, look into the important methods which is available in the thread class. So first one is get name. So this get name method is used to obtaining the thread's name. We'll use these methods in our upcoming sessions program. Thread get priority to obtain the thread's priority. is alive, which is a method which is to determine if the thread is still running or not. Join will in the thread lifecycle we discussed about this join and wait method, so which will transfer the state of thread from running into the waiting state. Run, so the entry point of a thread. In the previous example, we have discussed that when we call the start method, it will look into the run method, implementation of the run method, which is a starting entry point of a thread. Sleep. Sleep method is useful to transfer a thread life from running state to the timed waiting state. So we'll wait for a particular time. So usually it is specified in the milliseconds or nanoseconds. Start. So start, actually the start method calls the run method. So these are the some important methods available in thread class. In the coming programming sessions, we'll use some of these methods. So clear? Okay. And the second thread creation method. First, we created the thread by extending the thread class. And in the second type method, we are implementing a runnable interface. So this is the easiest ways to create a thread. So look at here. So we are creating a thread, but in the previous example, we extended the thread class, but here we implemented the, here we are going to implement the runnable interface. Okay, here also we have to implement the run method. Okay, we are creating the thread object and we are creating my thread object. Then we are creating the thread object and we are passing the my thread object to the thread object. So this is the general syntax for creating a thread by using the runnable interface. So there is small difference in the previous method and in the in this method. Okay, so we can check it in the Eclipse platform. So this is the example for the second method. Here we, instead of extending the thread class, we implement the runnable, and the runnable object is passed to the thread object. Okay, it looks similar to the previous one. There is no change in the execution. Okay, so definitely you have a doubt why we are using two methods to create thread, because already thread extending thread class will create thread and we can do every operations in by extending the thread class. Then why we need to implement a runnable interface? That's a doubt in your mind. Okay, just check it. So these are the difference between the extending thread class and implementing runnable interface. Okay, so all of you know that Java does not support the multiple inheritance, right? So that is the first issue by extending the thread class. So when you extend a thread class, after that you can't extend any other class which you require. So a class extends a thread class. So if that class want to extend some other class, it's not possible. It's possible in other language, but not possible in the Java, because Java does not support multi-threading. But if you are implementing the thread by using the runnable interface, then it's possible. We can extend some other class, because we are not extending any class. We are implementing the runnable class, so it can extend some other class. So that is the first difference between the implements runnable and extend thread class. And second one is, by extending thread class, each of your thread has a unique object associated with it. So every time when we create new thread objects, it takes different space in the memory. whereas implementing runnable means many threads can share the same object instance. So if you are using runnably, if you are implemented by using runnable interface and we creating the object, which means it's not took different spaces in the memory, there is only one object of instance is created. I think you have some doubt about this point, right? Let's look an example and how is the difference. Okay, so this is a program which is implemented to find the difference between implementing the runnable and extending the thread class. So here we have two class. First, a counter implementation which implements the runnable. This is just a counter program. Okay, so it initializes a counter and increments the counter number. So that's the program. So the first class is implemented by using the runnable interface, and second class by extending the thread. Okay, so this is by extending the thread, and this class is created by implements the runnable. Okay, and within the class there is a simple method, just counter. We implemented the method in the run, implemented method in the run. So we counter increments and just print the counter. Okay, in the main method, main class, we have created the object of the runnable interface and also created the object of the thread. Okay, so we created the object of the runnable interface, and by using the runnable interface we created three objects. Okay, object 1 using runnable interface, object 2 using runnable interface, and object 3 using thread 3, means thread 1 using runnable interface, thread 2 using runnable interface, and thread 3 using runnable interface. And in the next session we have created object of the thread using by extending the thread class, and we have created the first thread, second thread, and third thread. So this sessions, these threads are created by extending the thread class, and these threads are created by extending, by implementing the runnable interface. Okay, so clear. So one is runnable interface, one is extended thread class. So we'll look into the difference. Wow, that's the difference, because the runnable interface create only one object reference, and which object reference is used by the different threads, so that the counter gets incremented. But the thread, a point, but the thread which creates each unique object for different thread, by extending the thread class it will create the different object. That's why, so every time by we are creating a new thread, its counter is initialized to 1, because all these three threads are different objects. But in the runnable, all different threads are implemented by using a single object reference, so that the counter gets incremented, because in the previous we have initialized it to 1, so in the next time when the counter is automatically incremented. So that's the difference between the runnable interface and a, by extending a thread. I think it's now clear. Okay, so next topic we are going to discuss is multi-threading. So multi-threading means we are executing one or more threads simultaneously to maximize the utilization of CPU. That is multi-threading. So this is this diagram indicates. So here we have different CPU, two CPU, and an application has implemented application implemented in 4 threads. So 2 threads execute in the first CPU and 2 threads executing in the second CPU. So we can execute the whole process concurrently. So we can increase the speed of the execution. So if it's a sequential executed and it is executed by one CPU, then it will take time, more time. But here it is executed by two CPUs and parallelly, so it will take less time compared to the sequential execution. So why multi-threading means it's a better utilization of single CPU or the multiple CPU? Because CPU has more processing capacity than normal program executes. So we can increase the efficiency of the performance of the CPU by multi-threading, and the better user experience. Yes, in the word, in the Microsoft Word, will face different user, better user experience, because at the same time we can check the grammar of a sentence, we can check the spelling, we can check whether the first letter in the first word in the sentence is a capital, starts with a capital letter. So everything will check parallel by using different thread. So that is the power of thread, multi-threading. When we discuss about the multi-threading, I mean, when we implemented the multi-threading, there is an issue happens. Look into that issue. What is the issue? Then we come to the theory session. Suppose I just close all these tabs. Otherwise, it will make a confusion. Clear the terminal. Account testing. Okay, look at this example. So account testing example. So this is just a bank application. In a bank, there is some amount, and that is amount going to withdraw by different persons. Okay. This is a thread program. So we have a class account. So this is a common balance. A shared memory or a common value which is shared by the different threads. So if a common value is shared by different threads, in the previous examples we have seen that the threads executed based upon the thread scheduling algorithm at different way. So it may be first thread executed in first time, in the next execution there may chance that second thread execute first. So it will not a continuous process, it will a parallel process. So here two customers are going to withdraw their money, Suma and Sunny. Each time they will withdraw rupees 10 from the balance. So total we have 50 balance. Each time they will withdraw their rupees 10 from the balance and the account is updated. And we return the program that if at no condition, at no circumstance, the balance will not fall below than zero. So if it is zero, we can stop the withdraw process, but at no condition it will not fall less than zero. So if it falls less than zero, it is identified here and will display the account is overdrawn. Okay, just run the program. Okay, so we run, Suma is going to withdraw. Oh, so automatically it, now the account balance becomes 14. Okay, again Sunny is going to withdraw, so account balance will be 30 rupees, and here also withdraw operation by Suma, so it will be 20 rupees. Sunny withdraw the amount 10 rupees. Again, Sunny is going to withdraw the amount. Now it reads 0 rupees. But again, the Suma is going to withdraw. So now it reaches minus 10 rupees. Okay. So that's the problem. So multi-thread is executed and it is shared by a, and which shares a common memory, common area. As it is executed concurrently, which may result in some unwanted results, some error result, error results. Okay, I think now you are clear about why we need synchronization. So we need a synchronization such that at a time only one thread can access this value. So now the two thread is able to access this value concurrently, and they concurrently tries to modify it. So that's why the balance amount mismatch. So we need a synchronization here. That is, if one program is executing modifying values here, we have to block all other threads, right? That is synchronization. So we are going to discuss that issue in the synchronization. And synchronization is done in Java by using the keyword synchronized. So synchronize keyword is used to perform synchronization or concurrency in Java. And this keyword ensures that only one thread is accessing the shared location or shared memory. At that time, if any other thread try to access their shared location or shared memory, they have to wait till the currently executing thread to be or thread operation to be complete. So that is the use of synchronized keyword. So it protects the resource. So synchronized keyword can be used with a code block and a method. So we can use the synchronized keyword in two ways, by using a code block and by using a method. This is the syntax of synchronized block. So we are using the keyword the synchronize, and we are specifying the object here, then the statement which is going to execute in the synchronized statement, the critical session. So when a thread wants to execute a synchronized statement inside a synchronized block, it must acquire a lock on the lock object. So all other thread must wait till this thread currently acquired lock finish its execution, then only they can access this synchronized statements. So in this way, synchronized keyword guarantees that only one thread will executing the synchronized block statements at a time, and this prevent multiple threads from modifying the data inside the block. And the second method is synchronized method. In the previous statement, previous example, we have used a synchronized blocks. What are the statements which require synchronization? We put it in a block. In the second method, we create a synchronized method. We create the method itself as a synchronized method. So after the access modifier, before the return type of the method, we have to specify. This is a synchronized method by using the keyword synchronized. So the synchronized keyword tells the compiler that this is a synchronized method. So only one thread can access this method at a time, and no other threads are allowed to execute this method. So once a thread is executing this method, all other thread which tries to execute this method have to wait till the already executing thread have to complete their operation. So by using this thread, the synchronized block and synchronized method, we can implement the synchronization, which means the concurrency in the Java. Okay, let's look at an example. So in the previous example, without synchronizing, the error output happened, the unwanted output happened. So we are going to change it into So this is the method which access the balance and update the balance, right? So it withdraws and update the balance here. So we are going to set it as a synchronize method. Now the method changed to synchronize. After the access modifier, before the return time, we included a keyword synchronize. So this synchronize keyword is applied at the level of method. So that's why it is called synchronize method. So now only one thread can execute this method. All others has to wait. Okay, run it now. So look at here, it stops the withdrawal operation at 0. So we will not move to the negative balance. Okay, so first Suma is going to withdraw. Then after the Suma completes his operation only, Sunny is allowed to access the object. After completing the operation of Sunny only, next Suma can access the method. So here we implemented the synchronization. Okay, just look into another example. So this is another example. So this is an example which generates multiplication table. So we'll create two threads to print multiplication table for 5 and multiplication table for 100. Okay, so no synchronization is implemented here. First, in this, so all synchronization statements are commented. So no synchronization statement is implemented in this program. Now just run this program, we'll get the unwanted output, because the 100 and 5, the output come in a mixed way. So here the multiplication table for 5, it is for 100, again 5, again 100, again 5, then 200. So it's not in executed in an order way. So we can ensure this execution by synchronization. So first I am using the synchronized method. Okay. Sorry, synchronized block. So here I am using synchronized block. So synchronized block is created by using synchronizer. Then object, this means we are, this is this pointer which points to the current instance of the program, right? So we apply the synchronized block. So this is the method which prints the multiplication table. So we applied a synchronized block within the print multiplication table method. Inside the print multiplication table method, we have implemented a synchronization block. Next look at the output. Yeah, that's correct. So initially it prints the 5 table and next it prints the 10 table. So always it not be like that. Sometimes it first print the, if the second thread access the synchronized object first, then it prints the 100, then it prints the 5. Just look at second time. Again, now also it prints the 5, then 100. So we can try once more. Again it is 5, then it is 100. So maybe multiple execution may change. In multiple execution may change, maybe there's a chance that 100 come first. Okay. So that's the first way, by applying the synchronization method. Okay, next we can comment the synchronization for a synchronization block. We can comment the synchronization block. Then we are going to apply the synchronization method. So change it into a synchronized method. So now we are using a synchronized method. So we are applying the synchronized keyword in the method itself. So previously it was implemented as a block within a method. Now the method itself is changed to synchronize method. Run this, it will also print the same result. Okay, so all the tables in the file number 5 is printed, then the tables in the 100s are printed. So this is the advantage of synchronization and the use of synchronization in Java. Right. I think now we are clear about it. So next topic, the last topic in this video lecture, is the priority of thread. Priority means when a thread is in runnable state, the thread scheduler decides which thread is going to run next time. So which is done by using a priority. So priorities are represented by between 1 and 100. So the priority of a thread will be between 1 and 100. In most cases, the thread scheduler schedules the thread according to their priority, but it is operating system dependent. So we can guarantee that it is run based upon the priority, because if there is a different thread implementation, thread prior scheduling algorithm is implemented, it may vary. Anyway, usually the thread priorities varies from 1 to 10. So these are the three constants which is available in the thread class. Min priority, which means the priority is 1. Normal priority, which means the priority is 5. Max priority, priority is 10. So the maximum priority is 10, minimum priority is 1, and the normal priority is 5. In the thread methods, we discussed about a method called set priority. So we have two methods in thread class: set priority to set the priority of a thread between 1 and 10, and get priority, which returns the current priority of the thread. So next we can look into the examples of thread priority. Okay, close it, clear it. Okay, close this to program. Okay, thread priority. This is a demos which returns a thread priority. Okay, here we have a class which extends the thread class, and we created three objects are created, and we get the priority of the thread. So the first priority of the first thread, priority of the second thread, and priority of the third thread. So by default the priority will be 5. Okay, let's comment all these statements, because we are creating a thread and just want to print the priority of this thread. Okay, the first thread priority is 5, second thread priority is 5. So by default the priority is normal priority, that is fifth priority. Okay, so next then we are going to set different priorities for these threads. So we set the priority of the first thread to 2, we set the priority of second thread to 5, and we set the priority of third thread to 8, and we are going to get the priority. Okay, also one important thing in Java is, even if we are not created the any threads in our program, the JVM creates a thread for the main program. So main program also is run as a thread program. Okay, so we are getting the main thread priority also. So main thread priority is also getting, this main thread priority will more priority than all others, because the main method has to run first. The main program, main class has to run first. So it will have higher priority than all other priorities. Okay, just look it. Okay, so the first thread priority is set to 5. So this is the default priority. Then we set the priority to 2, 5 and 8, and the main thread priority is the normal priority, and we set the priority of main thread to 10. Okay, so by this way we can set the priority of the threads. Next we can look another example. This is another example. Here we created two threads, first thread and second thread. And the first thread we given the minimum priority, that is minimum priority means priority 1. And the second thread we give the maximum priority. And we started two threads. So definitely it will execute the first second thread first, because it gives the it we provide the second thread higher priority, right? Yeah, it executed the second thread first, because second thread have the higher priority than the first thread. So we just change it. Now we can change the program, can change the priority. So I'm going to change the max priority and change the second one into min priority. Okay, then execute, try to execute this program. So here the first thread is executed, because the first thread has the higher priority than the second thread. So the first thread executed first. In the previous execution it was the second thread, but now it's changed to first thread. So first thread dot java executed. Okay, so that's the priority in Java thread. Okay, so we discussed about what is thread, how can we create the thread by using extending thread class and by implementing the interface, then multi-threading, thread lifecycle, then different types of synchronization which we can apply on threads, and the thread priorities in this session. So hope you have got some idea about thread. So thank you for the patient listening, and thank you for the support which you have given in the previous lectures. Thank you.